First of all, I was wondering if maybe you could tell us a little bit about the history of you and this book and how it came to be.
Sure. Well, for those who are not familiar with my work, because there are no newspapers anymore, I'm known as a political cartoonist first and foremost, and I've done books on a lot of different formats. I've done political polemics. I've done travelogues, including from Afghanistan and Central Asia, war correspondency, cartoon collections, just lots and lots of books, very few of whom have sold very well. And there was, about a year and a half ago, my publisher at Seven Stories Press came to me and said, hey, how about a graphic biography of Edward Snowden? And my first reaction was like, no, because someone else has obviously got to be working on a biography of Snowden, so who's going to want my comic book version of it? But as it turned out, no one was working on a biography of Snowden. After the story broke in the summer of 2013, there just wasn't much. The story kind of almost died by 2014, by the end of it, at least in the mainstream media. And for whatever reason, there just wasn't a bio. So I did what all writers do in these situations. I put it off as long as I possibly could. And then I ended up just being a total pain in the ass to everyone I knew and just going underground, and I will not say for how long, but for kind of a shorter time than you would think, and drawing this thing all at once. So the idea of this book was initially just do a bio. But as I got into it, I realized that it needed to show what the NSA was doing and to put it into a political, social, and cultural context. When I was talking to, I would meet people on the plane or whatever, and they'd say, oh, what's your next project? And I'd say, I'm writing a book about Edward Snowden. Most people didn't even know who he was. And I mean, this was in the United States, I'm saying. I mean, people did not know, they did not know his name. And if they did know who he was, they just had the vague outline. Like, you know, like, oh, isn't he that guy who, I don't know, he's a spy or something? And they didn't know. And so I realized that when I was doing the research for this book, why that was the case. There was a blizzard of detail that came out all throughout the summer of 2013. And it's been followed up by The Intercept and the work of that Glenn Greenwald and other people over there are doing. And so it's almost too much information, and people just kind of shut down. And so I wanted to almost take a YA approach, a young adult approach, and put this into a context where even if you weren't following the story, you could pick it up and in one or two sessions of reading, pretty much get your Snowden brain dump. So there it is.
Okay. What sort of research did you do as you were putting the book together? Did you sift through all of that information all at once again a second time?
Yeah, I mean, like I think like any biographer, and I love biographies. This is my first biography, but it's all biographies and history are almost all I read. So I've always wanted to do one, and I just read everything, every magazine story, every news article, everything I could find online, everything that I could find in English or French, the only two languages I can read. And I originally intended to have this be an authorized biography. I approached Snowden. And he refused to participate. So I was just very unhappy about that initially, and I was just very disappointed. And I figured, okay, well, this book is going to kind of suck because all it's going to really do is pull everything together and compile it, but that's not really bringing something new to the table culturally or politically. And so when the book was finished, my publisher sent a PDF to Snowden via his lawyer at the ACLU, and happily, we got a bunch of edits back via the ACLU from Edward. So it's kind of, now I feel really good about the book because it's both independent and not an authorized biography, which is still allows me some credibility. But at the same, so there's, I can address criticisms of him, for example, that probably wouldn't be in the book if I had worked with him from the start. But it also kind of corrected a lot of the mistakes that were in the mainstream media. And there were quite a few pretty serious and errors about his life and about his escape from Hong Kong and so on that have been, that are fixed here. So This is the story pretty much as we know it so far, I think.
And did he give a reason why he did not want an authorized biography?
I kept asking, and no, he didn't get, you know, he's a cagey dude, and I can only guess maybe he's thinking of working on his own biography at some point. I don't know.
Okay. And do you have any sort of specific examples of corrections that he offered? Anything that surprised
you? Yeah, sure. Well, like, there's been a lot of speculation about how he got out of how he got stuck in Russia and what happened there. And what happened was that, I mean, I bet you don't, you know, if you get a passport, you know that little bug microchip logo on the front of your new passport? Well, they say that that's for your convenience, so you can zip through, like, the security line faster or whatever. So what that's really for is for turning off your citizenship if you steal government secrets. So what happened was that Snowden had a permit to board, had a visa to go to Ecuador via Moscow and then Havana, Cuba, and then on to Ecuador, kind of a long, precarious lot of transfers. And the U.S. accused the Chinese government that administers Hong Kong of deliberately allowing him to escape without a permit. But that wasn't true. He had that permit, and he had a valid passport when he boarded that Aeroflot flight to Moscow. But while he was in the air on the way to Moscow, Hillary Clinton, Secretary of State at the time, turned off his passport. So when he arrived at Sheremetyevo 2 and went to the transfer counter to say that he wanted to go onward to Havana, someone told him, "I am sorry, sir, you have problem with passport. Passport not yet working." And so he was not. He was stuck in Moscow, which, just parenthetically, is an incredibly stupid move on the part of the U.S. government. You really want to get your guy stuck in Moscow, of all places? Like, wouldn't you rather let him leave Moscow and then arrest him or bring down his plane, as they did with the president of Ecuador later, as it traveled over American allies in Western Europe? So, anyway, but that's one example. So a lot of people said, well, you know, the Chinese let this happen. Actually, Hillary Clinton made this happen.
I wanted to ask you a little bit about tone, because in that anecdote, when you were talking about microchips and passports, and you said, "But what they really do," it sounds like a, you know, unraveled conspiracy theory that is not true. But we know it's true. But did you have to tone police yourself to keep from sounding like you were, you know, one of the people with the signs all over the you know, with the connecting yarns and things like that, like?
Absolutely, yeah. No, I always have to tone check myself, even in my most outrageous cartoons, because it's America, the land of flat affect, and I want to live in, like, you know, England, where Steve Bell at The Guardian, the editorial cartoonist there, can draw the president like eating his own shit. And with his head up his ass, and it's awesome. And you know, and here it's like, here there's no, like, bomb throwing. You really want to always pull back. I found that my most successful work here, and I mean successful both in terms of sales and in terms of reaching a broader, wider audience, is always from pulling back, restraining myself, and kind of having that dry Jon Stewart type delivery. And people just like that. I mean, this is the country that I live in, so this is how I have to communicate. But I really restrained myself a lot when writing this book in particular. And it is a biography, and I kind of also felt that with Snowden, this isn't like climate change, you know, where there's really only one point of view that's legitimate, and then there's the assholes. It's like, criticisms of Snowden are legitimate and worthy of consideration and ought to be treated with respect, and I felt that it was important to do that.
Okay. What about your history with Edward Snowden? Do you remember when you first heard about him?
Yeah, I do. I was at home in my house in East Hampton, New York, when I got a text message from Matt Bors, who's a brilliant young cartoonist based in Portland. And whenever I get a text message like this from Bors, I know I have to immediately turn on the TV. But it was like, "Holy f-ing shit, Prism." And I'm like, MSNBC or CNN, and it's and then it was like we were just talking to each other, and we were like, oh my God, on the phone, like this is unbelievable. This is the biggest story of our lives. This is huge. This is bigger than 9/11. This is so important. And we were like, literally, this is how naive we were. We were like, everything's going to change now. Oh my God, there could be a revolution. Ha ha ha. So, but we really just thought it was just amazing. And yeah, and I remember first the program came out, and then we got word this guy issues this video. I watched it online, and I remember just thinking like, God, this is just amazing that it's this young guy. How on earth was he in a position to get these secrets?
And one of the programs outlined in the book is captivated audience, in which the NSA can spy on people through phones like this one, which are turned off, and yours should be turned off too. So they can actually surveil through devices that are turned off. And there was another program in the book that you talked about that I was unaware of and embarrassed to learn about, where the USPS, the Postal Service, scans every piece of mail, billions of pieces of mail a year. As you were looking through, did you have any surveillance fears that didn't come true?
No.
Were you surprised to learn this? Or a lot of people said that they weren't really surprised when they found out about what Snowden.
I was prepared to a probably bigger extent than the average person, because I had read about an old 1980s program called Echelon, which was an NSA program, and back in the 80s, and you know, NSA was chartered in 1947. To intercept all signals intelligence between foreign sources and foreign sources, and between foreign sources and American sources. So they've, ever since the 1980s, they've been wanting to collect everything. And at the time, the NSA was very open, particularly in the European media for some reason, about wanting to collect, at that time, every telex, fax, phone call, and other similar type communications, bank wire transfers. And they were very overt about this, and how they at the time worked with 26 other major nations. They were really engaged in all sorts of incredibly strange methods of doing this. Like they had divers, U.S. Navy divers, go miles beneath the Atlantic Ocean, to the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean, and they drilled cables into the transatlantic cables that carry fiber optic communications between Europe and the United States. They drilled into nodes. They had special satellites. So I knew that the NSA wanted to do this, and that they were this was a huge institution with an unlimited budget. But when I started researching the Snowden book and all the revelations, the detail of the, not only the interception, but the storage, and the fact that it's all-encompassing is what shocked me. I mean, we are talking about everyone in this room, all of your emails, all of your text messages, all of your voiceover internet phone calls, etc., 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 your license plates being scanned by the local police as you drive through the streets. All of them. It's not maybe, it's not probably, it's not a lot of them, it's not 99% of them, it's not most of you, it's all of you, and it's all of your communications all the time. They're even intercepting your Netflix streaming habits, and they complain that they have to have so much storage that it's costing billions of dollars because video files are so big. And so literally 65 to 70% of all bandwidth intercepted by the NSA is you watching Game of Thrones. And I know ISIS, I've read that ISIS likes Game of Thrones, so maybe you're in league with ISIS. But it's actually just incomprehensible. And it's like, obviously the technology has advanced to the point where the interception, the big data algorithms, and the storage capacity has suddenly become feasible on a vast scale, on a scale that's, you know, that really dwarfs East Germany and the Stasi. Mm-hmm.
Okay. In the book, you wrestle with why Edward Snowden was the only one to come forward. And you float a lot of theories, but it seems like you're still, at the end of the book, you're still a little unclear as to why. I mean, did you have any insights into his character that you think make him especially prone to being the only one with access to this information? Because a lot of people had access to this information.
Yeah, Edward Snowden is literally one in a million, literally, because 1.4 million NSA and CIA and other intelligence staffers or private security contractors had access to many or all of the same documents that he revealed. And yet, he's really the one, except you could also say, you could add Thomas Drake to that list. So he's maybe two in a million. And it's why these guys. And so I interviewed Drake in Washington. Thomas Drake was an NSA whistleblower of the mid-2000s who tried to work within the system and go to the Senate Intelligence Committee and so on. And he was rewarded by the whistleblower protection that involves the FBI breaking into your house in front of your wife and kid at 6 o'clock in the morning and taking careful steps to get you blackballed from every possible company that might hire you and then prosecuting you on espionage charges and ruining your life. And so he's now working the Genius Bar at an Apple store in suburban Maryland outside of Washington. So I asked him over dinner, what is it about you, like, why did you do it? And he kept saying, well, it was wrong. Anyone could see it was wrong. Anyone could see that it was violated the Fourth Amendment. Anyone could see that our privacy rights were being decimated. And I was like, yeah, but all your colleagues saw it too. So why did you do it and why didn't they do it? And he kept saying the same thing, well, it was wrong. And so I was trying to get at, really like hold his feet to the fire, because after all, I paid for dinner and I wanted my answer. I was like, why are you so special? And he had some, finally he kind of said, well, you know, I grew up in Vermont. It's a state that values independent individualism, and it has a town hall meeting structure, so people are very engaged in democracy, and I always felt I believed these things we learned in civics class. But the point is that I've read so much about like why Chelsea Manning did it, why did Daniel Ellsberg step forward with the Pentagon Papers, and they all kind of say the same things. I don't think they really know why, what's different about them, why are they wired that way. I mean, certainly their critics might say they're arrogant. That's one of the big criticisms of Snowden. He knows better. It's like, well, he did know better. I think the question is, why did everyone else not know better? People look at World War II in France and say, well, why were only 1 or 2% of the French involved in the French resistance? And it's like, well, that's like a lot more than the, that's 1 or 2% more than would be involved in one here. So, I think that he did certainly have some things that point toward an unorthodox background. Look, he's a child of divorce, so what? That's half of my generation and probably half of his. My parents were divorced, I didn't do anything like that. I'm not a rebel. He dropped out of high school. He had mono when he was 16, ended up having to get a GED. So he's like a little bit of the outsider there. Didn't really care about the educational system, which is meant to indoctrinate us into the world of work and citizenship. Never even finished his community college education, never got his associates. And he did everything sort of, he was into gaming, but so what? Gaming's a billions and billions of dollar business. Lots of people are involved in gaming. He worked for the government, but he knew he was going to work for the government. His parents worked for the government. His siblings worked for the government. There's nothing you can really point to except maybe he voted for Ron Paul. I mean, it's there's no one thing.
Yeah. I don't want to ruin this for anyone who hasn't read the book, but in the end, you highlight a ridiculous NSA outreach program, and you come to the conclusion that they know they're in trouble, which is a quote from the book. But When I read that, I was wondering, what does an unconstitutional, untouchable government agency have to be worried about, really?
Yeah, well, I will not give away, no spoiler here for this part thing at the end of the book, which you could just, as long as you shoplift the book, I'm cool, but just get the book. I mean, because I get paid if you steal it. So there's a tracking thing on it, though, and they follow you with the drone. But like, so it's about propaganda. It's about the NSA's propaganda efforts. And propaganda is in every society, and even in an authoritarian regime under, say, Saddam, or under the former leader of Turkmenistan, who was famous for being a crazy despot, or under Nazi Germany, you always have a need to propagandize children, everybody, because you still need the consent of the governed, whether you're in a nominal democracy like the United States or whether you're in an absolute dictatorship, because fundamentally, the government is afraid of its people. The government knows that it's only there on the sufferance of its people. And so when given a chance, it's kind of like, if you own a really big dog that could take you in a fair fight, some nights you got to worry that that dog might decide to bite you. And and they're worried about us because they know that, when governments change, it's because they change in violent ways, and they don't want that to happen.
Do you think that there's a happy ending in this story?
Well, the happy ending so far has been in a way that I, as a socialist, would have never anticipated. There's kind of been some movement from the free market angle, and as Snowden would have wanted, because he's a very libertarian guy. For example, the iPhone 6 is encrypted point to point. So if you make a call or issue a text message on your iPhone 6 or 6 Plus or whatever, that is dark to NSA. If you use, because of the Snowden revelations, there are now apps. For example, I use one called Signal. It's free for iOS and for Android that allows you to send text messages and make phone calls completely encrypted, PGP, Snowden approved, NSA is not listening. Make all your calls to ISIS on that. The Europeans, for example, have started building their Euro cloud to compete with Google's American cloud, which Google a lot of the major tech companies, including Google, were in bed with the NSA until 2013. The only major tech company or telecom that wasn't was T-Mobile, but all the other ones, AT&T, Verizon, et cetera, were. And so the Europeans are definitely reacting to all this. The United States U.S. Silicon Valley businesses have lost billions, if not trillions, of dollars in business to companies that have moved their business out of the United States because they don't want their material, their data exposed to the NSA, which was found to be doing industrial espionage as one of the Snowden revelations. So there's been some movement in the private marketplace, and there's been some movement in certainly internationally, but there hasn't been really anything here in the United States. The only program that has gotten any airtime since 2013 has really been the telephone metadata program. And telephone metadata is the stuff that's on your phone bill, like what time you made a call, how long it lasted, who you called, where you were, where they were. That's it. So if you look at your phone bill, that's kind of it. And so Obama said that he wanted to reform that program, but he didn't. And Congress sort of talked about it, but they're not. And that was it. That was the entire post-Snowden debate. And it's like a fraction of 1% of what the NSA is up to. And like the defenders of that program say, well, you don't have to worry about that because that program isn't listening to your phone calls. And that's true because they have another program that listens to your phone calls. And then if they talk about that program that listens to your phone calls, they say, well, don't worry about that one because that one doesn't store your phone calls, because that's true. We have another one that stores the phone calls. And so there's so much sophistry and misdirection. For example, vis-a-vis the idea of collection. James Clapper, the director of National Intelligence, who was caught brazenly lying to the Senate under oath, he said that that the material is not actually collected when, even if it's taken from your device and then it's stored on their computers in a data farm in Utah, they don't actually have it. It's not actually collected until an analyst goes and listens to it or reads it or watches it. And so I'm like, well, by that standard, then the Library of Congress doesn't collect any books. Because until someone, a librarian, goes and opens the book, it has not been collected. That is exactly the same logic. And, you know, it's kind of like if you have my naked pictures and you just are too bored to look at them, first of all, I'm insulted, and secondly, I'm like pissed off because you shouldn't have my naked pictures. So, and speaking of naked pictures, that's something that Snowden revealed too, that the NSA has lots of naked pictures of Americans because they like to turn on the little camera in your device, and which could be unplugged, by the way, while they do this, and they can watch people and video them in their own homes, and they do all the time, and they catch them having sex, and they save the videos, and they trade them, and they do this all the time for fun. This is your tax dollars at work. You know. Meanwhile, we can't rebuild a school, but.
I'm sure nobody here does anything disgusting in front of their computers ever. So I wanted to ask you a little bit about the craft here. Was the book always set up the way it is, with mostly one picture per page and some text, rather than, did you ever anticipate it as a more of a traditional comic with panels and word balloons and captions?
That's such a good question. Originally, when I was doing it, I thought of it just naturally as multiple panels per page, because that's how all comics are. And when my publisher came back with the size, I experimented with different approaches to this, and I realized that multiple panels per page just were too small. And you know, I'm 52, my eyes aren't what they used to be, and so I'm kind of influenced by that. And I wanted a book that was, you know, easy to read. I mean, there are books that I won't read Doris Kearns Goodwin because the font on her books is too small. And it's like, make them longer and make the font bigger and more letting. I just need that. So simple images per page seem to work best for this.
Okay. Now I think right when this book came out, there was some issue with the LA Times and the LAPD and all that, and it was kind of reported in a sort of lopsided way, and I was wondering if maybe you'd be willing to talk about that. And then we will jump to your questions, so start thinking up some good ones.
Sure. How many people have heard of this LA Times, LAPD thing? Okay. I'm sorry. So as for the rest of you, I'll fill you in. So until July of this year, I was the cartoonist at the LA Times on the editorial page. And I had that position since 2009. And this story I'm about to tell you kind of ties into the Snowden book in that it kind of addresses that question, you know, if you're not doing anything wrong, you shouldn't be worried about government surveillance or state surveillance. And here's an example of someone, me, not doing anything wrong, being subjected to state surveillance and still nevertheless getting screwed over. So what happened was that in May of this year, LAPD announced a crackdown on jaywalking. And my cartoons were about local issues, so I did a cartoon about it. And to accompany that cartoon, I wrote a blog that appeared in the online edition at latimes.com that contained, started out with a little personal anecdote of when 14 years earlier, back in 2001, I was arrested in the West Hollywood section of LA for jaywalking. And and by the way, I wasn't jaywalking, which, you know, I'm a New Yorker, okay? So I'm just saying, I know from jaywalking. It's like, jaywalking should not even be illegal at all. There's the applause line.
15 years ago, that would have been sacrilege in Seattle.
Yes,
that was a big thing.
If you jaywalk, the terrorists have won. I was walking along, this cop, apparently with a quota to fill, didn't like the cut of my jib, grabbed me, spun me around, threw me against a wall, handcuffed me, wrote me up for a ticket, attracted quite a crowd of people who were upset at what they saw, and then they were yelling at him and stuff. And then ultimately one of his colleagues showed up, and he gave me my ticket, and then he said, here's your license back, not, and threw my license into the gutter. At the time, I was furious, and I'm still angry about it when I think about it. And I filed a complaint with the Internal Affairs Division of the LAPD. They ignore 98.4% of all internal affairs complaints. And even though, you know, I did have white privilege working for me, they ignored mine too. And so I didn't hear from them, and that was that. I've so skip forward to 2015, May of this year. I mentioned this thing runs in the LA Times. A couple months later, I get a call from the LA Times from a reporter who says, LAPD's questioning your story. And I said, what do you mean? And he says, well, they say it didn't happen. It's like, and I said, of course they would say that. He says, yeah, yeah, they say there was none of it. The angry crowd, the license toss, the being roughed up, being handcuffed. You were never handcuffed. That couldn't have even happened. I said, really, it couldn't have happened? He goes, yeah, the officer in question has never used his handcuffs in 20 years on the job. And I said, not even with his wife? And then he's, you know, I was like, this guy's like the biggest slacker ever. I mean, I was like, and so anyway, he's like, I'm like, well, whatever, they can say whatever they want. And he goes, well, they have proof. And I'm like, what do you mean they have proof? And he goes, yeah, he was secretly tape recording your arrest. And they gave us, the LAPD gave us the tape. And I'm like, what? Like 14 years ago, LAPD was secretly audio taping people they were arresting for jaywalking?
Also, I'm sorry to interrupt, is that legal for them to record you without telling you?
It is legal in the state of California.
Okay.
But they never use the tapes because they never hold up in court. They're only used for firing cartoonists from newspapers.
All right, sorry,
really.
Continue.
Yeah, so, but that's a very specific purpose that we, you know. So, yeah, so I'm like, at this point, I'm very upset. I mean, how is this possible? I mean, I'm like Winston Smith in 1984, sure that we've always been at war with East Asia, and suddenly I know we've always been friends with East Asia, and I'm just freaking out, and I'm like questioning my own memory, and but I'm like, no, I know I was handcuffed. You don't really forget being handcuffed or thrown up against a wall, and when you're 6'2", you don't forget a cop who's 6'4 or 6'5 either. And so you know, we go back and forth. The guy drills me, asks me all sorts of insane questions, like why we can't hear the driver's license hitting the ground. And I was like, because we live on Earth with the laws of physics that apply on Earth. It's like, it's made of paper. Like, what was it supposed to make? Like, my 11-year-old son heard me talk about it, and he's like, what sound is the driver's license supposed to make? Like, it's like, but he's smarter than a George Polk Award-winning investigative journalist from the LA Times. So, anyway, so finally the dude sends me a digitized version of this audio file, a WAV file, and in the interest of transparency, I listened to it for the first time with him on the phone. And you can listen to this on my website, or you can go to a new domain.net, and there's other places where this tape has been embedded, and you can listen to it. It's 6 minutes and 20 seconds of 20 seconds of talk of the officer, and then the rest of it is, and so Paul Pringle, the reporter, says, so what do you think? You know, I'm tired, it's 9:30 at night. I go, I think this is a joke. And he goes, no, it's not a joke. I go, you're right, it's a fucking joke. And then he's like, well, anyway, this is, so the thing starts spinning out of control. 24 hours later, they've already made the decision to fire me. 3 days later, without having any kind of redressed, no ability to talk to my editors. My editor's on vacation in Japan. She doesn't even know about any of this. Turns out this is coming from the highest levels, by the way. It's coming from the publisher of the LA Times, a guy named Austin Buettner, billionaire, former deputy mayor of LA. My editors aren't even involved in any of this. They cut me loose and they published this editor's note that paints me like the new Jason Blair or Stephen Glass, a lying sack of shit fabulist. And it's just, I don't cry a lot. I cried. I was so devastated. And when this thing appeared, fortunately for me, and this is like where, yes, the internet has completely destroyed political cartooning, but it did save my ass in this one case, because people read the story and there were these audio experts from all around the country who asked me to send them the file to see if they could enhance it. And 2 days later, one of them successfully got a really clean copy, clean as we could expect, given the quality. And you could hear, among other things, a woman screaming at the cop, take off his handcuffs. So, and the subject line from the audio expert was, Merry Christmas. So, I was like, oh my God, this is gonna be huge, right? This is gonna be great. Like, of course, as soon as I contact my editors at the LA Times, they will immediately do what any good journalistic organization would do and investigate, look into it, and decide if they are proven wrong to retract and apologize and reverse their decision, right? So anyway, there's more on that tape too, that there's other people screaming at the cop, sexual innuendo, making fun of him, implying that he wants to sodomize me. I mean, they're pissed. And so I send this tape and the links and everything to all the editors at the LA Times. Crickets, no answer. Nothing. Not even like, we can't hear you. Nothing. And so basically this builds in social media. Twitter's going crazy, Facebook and so on. And then there starts getting a lot of coverage, like in the Guardian, in International Business Times. New York Observer did their own analysis of the tape. They got the same results. Greg Palast, the investigative reporter, did his own analysis, got the same results. So finally, the LA Times is feeling the heat after 3 weeks. And so what do? They double down and publish another analogous piece. And they hired their own analysts, right? They hired, there's enhancement of tapes and there's analysis of tapes. An enhancement makes a dirty tape clean so you can hear the voices that you can't hear. Analysis figures out, for example, if a tape has been tampered or spliced. So they had two experts, a guy who specializes in enhancement and a guy who specializes in analysis. So what did they publish? The enhancement guy said that his analysis revealed nothing and did not talk about enhancement. The analysis guy talked about enhancement and didn't talk about anything about his analysis. So they're gilding the lily, to say the least. And so anyway, now I'm in what they call a pre-litigation stage. And so that's where we are. And thank you.
You can applaud for pre-litigation, it's okay.
And yay, litigation.
Yeah.
I don't want to, but it's very time consuming and it's an ordeal, but there's really no choice. And there's a broader issue at stake here. I mean, there's there's some pretty nefarious connections between this major American newspaper, which is the most important newspaper west of the Mississippi River, and the police. For example, and I won't get into all the details, but the main one is that the LAPD pension fund is managed by a company called Oak Tree Capital. Oak Tree Capital is the number one shareholder of Tribune Publishing, which owns the Los Angeles Times. So in other words, the LAPD owns the Los Angeles Times. So when the LAPD calls the publisher of the LA Times, who, by the way, arranged for that transfer of money to Oak Tree Capital, there is a tendency for them to take that phone call and to take it very seriously. The forces at work are just like incredible.
Yeah.
I'm just one cartoonist. And it's like I'm arrayed against a heavily militarized police force and a newspaper chain that owns 20 newspapers. I mean, of course, granted, it's a newspaper chain. It could be much worse. It could be, you know, I don't
something
know.
That actually matters in 2015.
Yeah, a delicatessen.
I wanted to ask you, with your experience, are you a fan of the idea of body cams on police officers or no?
Yeah, I've editorialized in favor of body cams, but even, for example, the Sandra Bland video really reveals the limitations of these because the cops know how to fake things and to cover things up. Like, if you watch the Sandra Bland video, anybody else notice that her beating takes place off dash cam? Like, she's pulled off to the side. And so she's on the sidewalk saying, stop that, stop hitting me, why are you doing that? And she's very upset and crying. But if you're on a jury and you watch that dash cam, can you really say beyond a shadow of a doubt, beyond a reasonable doubt, can you convict an officer for beating her? You can't, because maybe she's faking it. Maybe she's just saying that. You can't see it. And so the point is the officers work around these things. I mean, for example, with the audio tape that was used in my case, the officer whistles throughout the tape, and when the enhancement guy like lifted away the whistles, it was under the whistles that are the angry passersby yelling at the cops. So they have these techniques where they tamp it down. Police surveillance is like in LA. They just approved these uniform cameras, and against the ACLU's recommendation, the federal government has decided to pay for them, even though the policy has been set up to protect LAPD. So whenever a Los Angeles officer comes back from his duties, he has the right, or she has the right, to review his or her dash cam video before writing up his or her situation report for the incident at hand, which obviously allows them to write a report that corresponds to what appears on the video. And the chief of police, Charlie Beck, told the LA Times, well, you know, it helps them remember. True. You know, I mean, it does help them remember. It also prevents them from being caught in lies. And it allows them to. So, I mean, you're acting. I mean, like, for example, my cop, you know, one of the reasons I was fired, they said there was a discrepancy between what I said and what they said because you can hear the cop being so polite. And he's like, here you go, sir. Here's your driver's license back. He sounds very polite and jovial while he's throwing my license on the ground. He knows he's being taped. Duh. I tried to explain that to the Times over and over, and it was just like talking to morons, but which I was.
All right, question.
When you were talking about your ordeal with the LA Times and the pretrial phase, you mentioned kind of offhand that you didn't want to do it. And obviously you don't have to, but it made me think about what you had said about the other whistleblower when you were asking him why he did it. And he said, well, it was just wrong. And I'm wondering if you see that kind of a connection between what you're having to go through suing the LA Times and what the whistleblowers did. And Paul, your question is, what the hell happened to the Schmanger last year?
The on-the-record thing with me at the Stranger is that I disagreed with the direction the paper was going in, and so I resigned. The off-the-record version is the sort of thing you should come up and ask me about after.
So you went in a different direction.
I did go in a different direction, yes. SeattleReviewBooks.com.
Yeah, it's like I just read about a series of layoffs that are about to happen in the Chicago Tribune, and they said, many workers will be realigned. Aligned out of work, I guess. So, yeah, I do see an analogy here. You know, opposing, you know, going out, and something like this is really hard. It's like, obviously, suing these people would not be a fraction as hard as what Snowden did, which took years for him to carry out, among other things, and he's stuck in Russia. I don't think I'll end up getting stuck in Russia as an example, but as a result. But yeah, I do see it. If I can find the right lawyer who's willing to do it on a contingency, I am going to do it. And there's a broader issue that's much more important than me, which is that the LAPD and police forces around the United States want to shoot black people like they're going out of season. But on top of that, they don't even want cartoonists to call them out on it when they do it. They don't even want any criticism whatsoever. And that's what this is about. They didn't like, I mean, if I'd been doing pro-LAPD cartoons, and I was the biggest lying sack of dung in American journalism, I'd still be working there. Probably would have gotten a raise. So the thing is, this is what this is about. And they've said so. The police union gloated about it on their blog, saying it's like great that this critic of the LAPD is gone. And they were behind it. So this is about collusion. It's about press freedom. I mean, you do not live in a democracy if a reporter or a cartoonist or an editor can be fired by a government agency. And that's what this is. Lord knows there's tons of examples of collusion between government and the media. Anyone who's ever seen the Gary Webb movie Shoot the Messenger knows that. But, and it's highly recommended, it's currently streaming online, definitely.
It's
I think
on
it's on
HBO
Netflix.
Right now.
HBO, yeah. If you have HBO Go, go watch it. But it's brutal. So yeah, I mean, I know this is one of those things where it's like time to take out the trash, but taking out the trash is never any fun.
But did that give you any insight into why Snowden and the other whistleblower did it?
Oh, I know that if I were in his position, I would have done the same thing. Absolutely. The difference is that I would have never been in a position like that because it's a guy like me, a lefty, was never going to be recruited by the NSA. So, when I was in college at Columbia, I went to the CIA recruiting table and I wanted an adventure. What can I say? And they told me straight out, like, yeah, we don't hire kids like you. And I said, what do you mean? And they said, yeah, this is true. They said, we prefer to hire Mormons from Utah. And I was like, really? And it's like, that's really fucked up. And then they were like, yeah, well, also, didn't you go to some socialist party meetings on campus? And I was like, communist too? And they were like, and you would think they'd want people from a variety of backgrounds, but they don't, or they didn't. Maybe things have changed. But I would never have been able to get a job like that. So that's why I would never be in a position to do something like that. What makes Snowden so unusual is that he came from such a conformist background and then made this political journey to do this radical act. That's just very rare. You know, it's like my next follow-up book to this is about Bernie Sanders. He's the opposite. This guy's had the same politics his entire life. Going back to his childhood, he's always been the same guy. So he didn't have a political journey. His story is about consistency, even through changing times. So it's just, that's very different.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hi. I was one of the people flyering outside before, but I came in because I really wanted to hear you.
Thank you.
And then when I heard your account of your difficulties with the police in LA, I decided I had to ask you what you think about this Rise Up October that we were leafleting about, where we're calling on people to fundraise to bring 100 of the families of people that have been killed by the police to be in October 24th in New York City, and I was wondering what you thought of that.
What's not to like?
What's not to like?
What's not to like?
But I mean, more than that, we're saying, which side are you on? Because people are, they say, oh, well, good luck to you. We really like, but we're saying, look, you have to take a stand, because if you're not doing something to stop it, it's kind of like the saying that the guy in Germany said, I didn't say anything when they came for them because it
Martin
wasn't
Niemöller.
Me. Yeah, right. Niemöller, yes. Anyway, that was what I was interested in asking.
Yeah, no, I mean, as they
I'll
said.
I'll leave you the flyer, too, in case you
haven't
seen it.
In the 60s, they said, right, if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. That's absolutely true. So, I think, if we sit and watch, if we don't say anything about and stand up to, among other injustices, police violence, then it's going to continue unabated. I mean, these cops are out of control completely. I mean, we are living in a police state, and I mean, I could just sit up here. I could have gone on for like an hour and a half. I'm a boring white guy. I don't do drugs. I have had so much trouble with cops, not just this one time. I heard so many other people have problems with cops. It's like, I mean, why are we putting up with this crap? I'm like America, land of the free and the brave. I was going through an airport in Kansas City a while back, and there was a young man who kept being put through the metal detector over and over. It kept beeping. It's like, go through one more time, very rudely, brusquely. And finally, he sheepishly told them, like, well, he goes, well, it's the titanium. And it's like, what? It's like, let's see, show us. And he lifts up his leg, because his leg got blown up in Iraq. And it's gone, okay? And like, what the fuck? And you know, that's the country we live in now. And you know, just like 2 years later, I was in Iran of all places, okay? Where I'm from the great Satan. And I'm at Ayatollah Khomeini International Airport. And they're like, I go to put my luggage through the baggage through the x-ray machine. And they're like, oh no, you are a guest in our country. It's disgusting to subject foreigners, guests in our country, to these kind of security measures. Like, that happened repeatedly. Like, just, I'm like, something's wrong, you know? Something's really wrong. We put up with way too much state oppression. All right, that's my spiel.
Okay. And I believe that these two in line are going to be the last two questions of the night. So.
It just boggles my mind when I sit on the bus and I see 95 people texting, and I look at my emails, plural, every day, and wonder, if everybody's doing that, what is the storage for that? How do they do that? I mean, where is that?
Oh, I'll tell you where it is. It's in Utah. You can go see visit all your old, you know, all those documents that you can't find, and like you do the search on your iPhone and you're like, I know I had that email, and it just doesn't come up. Like, they, Obama and his buddies, they have that in Utah. It's at this huge storage facility that they built out there, where it's perfectly safe from us, but not really for us. Pardon? Oh, well, yeah, so it's like the federal budget. It's incomprehensible to talk about numbers. I mean, you know, it's like you're talking like numerous tetraquads of data that are just going through the system. You know, it's like, imagine the last scene of Indiana Jones, but instead of it being like the Ark of the Covenant and all that other crap on the it's all servers, and it just goes on and goes on and it's on. It's in this air-conditioned series of buildings, and that's where they keep up to 5 years of your digital data. I mean, you're right, the storage is, the thing is that the technology has evolved to the point where it's so much cheaper and more efficient to store data than it ever has been. And so even though the system is awash in data, they never, you know, they have this new post 9/11 attitude. Before 9/11, they said that they were looking for a needle in a haystack when they were looking for example, a terrorist suspect. Now the idea is, this is their vernacular, that they want to gather the entire haystack and then store it and have it at their disposal to look through at their leisure. And so that's, you know, that library idea. They want to have everything there, and so there's no possibility of abuse of that. You know, Richard Nixon was impeached for tapping 120 phones. Yeah.
Thanks for your service, Ted. I've been enjoying your cartoons for years, especially during the Bush era. They were a great benefit.
Thank
for
you.
All of us. I want to talk about Snowden, a question about Snowden versus Assange. Mm. So Snowden was a person, a historical figure, who works to improve the secrecy and privacy of communications and transactions among everybody, including the most wealthy and powerful in our society. Assange, on the other hand, was a figure who worked to bring to the public visibility all kinds of secret material which turned out to be very valuable. So I've believed for a long time that if the actual transactions and communications of those at the top of power were publicly available, then the world would be a different place. In fact, it would be so much better that it's worth looking at changing the protections of privacy. So for that reason, I'm actually tired of hearing about Snowden, and I'd like to hear a lot more about Assange and about openness. I don't know, that's just my...
Thank you for bringing that up, because I don't take anything away from what Snowden did, because he's a hero of our time, for sure. But openness is crucial. I mean, I don't understand why cabinet meetings can be behind closed doors and not broadcast, simulcast online. I don't understand why government officials are allowed to meet at restaurants and discuss government business. I don't understand why city council should be able to have closed door meetings. To me, these are all people who work for us. They're government employees. They are our servants. They don't have any secrets. Their secrets are no secrets. They're our secrets. They don't have any right to privacy or reasonable expectation of privacy. They should be, everything they do should be completely exposed to us. Lord knows they want to know what we're up to. And as we've been discussing. So I think openness is crucial. You go into a city council or a school board meeting, you know, everybody stands up, and if there's a good turnout and members of the community come up and say their piece, but the votes have already been decided, the fix is already in, everything was already discussed down at the local watering hole weeks before, and it's all window dressing. So it's bullshit democracy. It's just, it's no more legitimate than a meeting of the Politburo. It's just crap. So I agree with you.
And let's please thank Ted Rall for coming to town. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Paul.